Well, good evening, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me on the line this evening. It's about 3 minutes till we get started. My name's Simon Graham, your host for this evening. And just while we wait for a few more people to join in tonight's webinar, perhaps you could just have a look at the question box and just type in your name, where you're from, and also what you're hoping to get out of tonight's webinar, just while we wait for a few people to come. And also let me know if you can hear me, of course. And also see my screen. You should see the presentation, how to use LinkedIn to find the executive job you want. So just type in there if you would, please. Hello, Marco from Italy. Fantastic. I'm trying to think of some Italian to say, but I won't embarrass it. Buongiorno. There we go. Who else have we got on the line? So what are you hoping to get out this evening? Marco, perhaps you want to type in the box and let me know. Simon Dumont, hello. Val, hello from the US. Wow, an international conference this evening, which is fantastic. Edward, hello. Duncan, fantastic. So let me just open up this box, actually. When you're playing around with technology, it can get slightly difficult, but here we go. So yeah, if you want to just type in there, hopefully I can see this, what you're looking... Okay, a better use of LinkedIn for yourself, Massimo. Fantastic. Yes, I'm going to show you how to do all of that and much, much more. I'm going to take you behind the scenes of LinkedIn this evening just to show you how I use it and how my clients use LinkedIn. So these are people I coach in the executive job market. Enhancing my LinkedIn profile. Okay, brilliant. Anybody else? Let me know where you're from. What you're looking to get from this evening. How to connect with the right people and recruiters and hiring managers. Okay, good. Well, I show people how to do that day in, day out. And I'm an ex-professional recruiter, so I'm going to give you the inside track as to how professional recruiters use LinkedIn this evening. So just give it a couple more minutes. I think we've got about 55 to 60 people booked on the call this evening. Can you just let me know if you can see my screen, actually? Can we just do that? We'll just do a bit of housekeeping first off. Can everyone see my screen? Yes. Derek says no. Yes. Yes. So you should see a screen that says how to use LinkedIn to find the executive job you want. Static picture. Ah, okay. Just bear with me a second. You should see a presentation slide with the Career Codex logo at the top, and it says how to use LinkedIn to find the executive job you want. We're doing these webinars, and I do quite a lot of them. There's always a slight time delay, so you shouldn't notice it too much, but actually there can be up to 30, 40 seconds, depending on where you are, based on what I say and what you see. So I'll try and accommodate that as we go through, but I'm sure you can imagine there's quite a lot to control from this end, and I maybe forget and maybe go too fast. So there's only a few slides this evening. We're going to get into the practicalities of how to use LinkedIn properly. So I think we're good to go. So I think we'll kick off, and let's jump into the first slide. So sound and visuals, okay. This is a platform called GoToWebinar. I use this on a regular basis. It's one of the industry leading platforms. If for whatever reason you get logged out, I get logged out, just use the link that you've currently got to come back in. So for whatever reason my system crashes, your system crashes, we'll get back to the presentation if you use the same link as before. You've already discovered the question box. As we go through, if you have questions that you want to ask me about the topics I'm talking about, pop them in there. If I don't get chance to cover them as we go, there's going to be about 15 to 20 minutes time at the end for Q&A. So I may not catch all of the questions. I'm doing this on my own this evening. I don't have a helper to pick out the questions for me, but I'll do my best to pick up both as we go. And as part of the registration for this webinar this evening, you will have received in your inbox a LinkedIn checklist. Did everyone get that? Just type in the box if you did. Please, hopefully you did. You don't actually need it, but if you look at your control panel, there's a PDF copy there, and if you want to download that, print it off your end, and use it to make some notes, then that's absolutely fine. It just gives you a bit of a guide as to some of the things that we're going to be talking about this evening. So we all good to go? Let's get right into it. So what are we going to cover today? So why have you signed up for this webinar? Well, what we're going to cover is three things principally, and then time for Q&A. So we're going to talk about why you need to be on LinkedIn. And as some of you will know, who I've had contact with previously, I ran a recruitment business for 5 years, and I also still work as a non-executive director in recruitment businesses. And funnily enough, I was helping out a business not in the recruitment space a couple of weeks ago, and I was sat in on what we call a beauty parade in the recruitment industry. So we met three executive recruitment firms, executive search firms, to decide who would get a piece of business. And what was very interesting, and this was some of the leading lights in the executive recruitment world, what was very interesting, that all of them said that as part of their candidate search, they would use LinkedIn as an extended database. So professional recruiters are using LinkedIn. It is their extended database. And as you'll find out, employers are using LinkedIn now to go direct to market. So no longer do they need to use job boards exclusively, or advertise in newspapers, and as we used to do it in the olden days. They can actually go direct to market, and many of the clients that I used to represent in my recruitment company, as well as talking to me, would also be looking direct in the market using LinkedIn. So it's really important that you're on there. But what I found when I was running my recruitment business, I would interview senior candidates that walked into my office, and I would ask them, do you have a LinkedIn profile? And the majority of them would say yes. But when I asked them, well, what are you doing with it proactively? Quite often they would look at me blankly and say, well, what do you mean? What should I be doing with it? Because anyone can create a LinkedIn profile. Now, whether it's good or not so good, well, we're going to get onto that in a little bit. But quite a lot of people miss the real power of LinkedIn, and that's to use it on a daily basis to proactively leverage your job search or promote your personal brand in the marketplace. And this is what we're going to talk about this evening. So tonight's training is really split into two parts. First of all, I'm going to show you how to use LinkedIn as what I call a shop window. It's a bit like having a shop on the high street. You dress your shop so it looks really nice to invite customers to come in. But really, it's quite reactive because you're reliant on people passing your shop window to come in. I'm also going to show you how to use LinkedIn as what I call a proactive engagement tool. And to use the shop analogy, this is like you putting on one of those boards or getting some leaflets and walking out of your shop into the high street and handing these leaflets out and encouraging people to come back and see what it is you've got. And that's a very proactive approach, and that's really where you can be in control of your job search. And one of the things that I teach through my various programs at Career Codex is the fact that really to be successful in the executive job market, and at any level really in the job market, you have to be proactive and you have to be in control every single step of the way. So we're going to do a bit of theory first off, because I need to set the scene, and then we're going to do some real practical applications. I'm going to pull up my my LinkedIn profile, I'm going to show you how I do it, I'm going to show you how I've constructed my profile, and please feel free to make some notes, ask me some questions, hence the Q&A bit on there as well. So at the weekend, yes, it was Easter, but I'm a little bit sad, and I decided I would read a 58-page document that LinkedIn sent me quite opportunely on, I think it was Thursday, Friday last week, albeit it says new for 2015, but I got sent it, and I thought I would read it, and it's the Sophisticated Marketer's Guide to LinkedIn. So this is really for people who use LinkedIn from a business development perspective. But I read this because I knew I was doing this this webinar, and I read it to get some insights for individuals on LinkedIn and how to promote themselves better. And there were really three key messages that came out of this reading. You don't actually need to read this document, because I'm going to tell you now the bits that you need to know. The first thing it said was that to be found on LinkedIn and to get the best response from LinkedIn, you need to have a complete profile. And LinkedIn's very good at prompting you to complete your profile. If you log in and you haven't done something, it will prompt you to do it. But having a complete profile is best advice to be seen on the platform by people you want to be seen by. The second point that came out of this document was it said that you've got to take advantage of all of the options on LinkedIn. So if there's an opportunity to communicate some information, some content, linked to the first point I made to a certain extent, you have to do it. But then there's things like groups, and we're going to talk about LinkedIn groups in a while. And you have an opportunity to be a member of 50 groups. And this document said that, you know, you've got to take full opportunity. So if there's an opportunity to be a member of 50 groups, then be a member of 50 groups. You don't necessarily need to communicate in all of those groups, because 50 is far, far too many to manage. But to tell the platform that you're a serious customer and that your profile is worthy of a look, then you've got to join 50 groups. Or best advice, you don't have to do anything, but best advice is that you join 50 groups. The other thing it said, which probably most of you know, is that really to increase your visibility to its maximum on LinkedIn, you need to have as many connections as you can. So these are first tier, second tier, third tier connections, and also group connections. And connections really are the lifeblood of LinkedIn. And I work very hard each and every day to make new connections with people in my industry, potential clients, people. I've read their articles online, I found them interesting, I read a book, I connect to the author. I'm building my network because I know that I connect to somebody, then I inherit their second and third tier connections. And if they share my content, like my content, then their second and third tier connections can see this. And we'll talk a bit more about why this is important later on. Now, LinkedIn can be quite frustrating because it's always changing. And I was coaching a client the other week, showing them how to do the get introduced thing on LinkedIn, only to find that it had disappeared. And I queried this with LinkedIn, and they told me, yes, they've stopped doing that now, but they don't formally announce this. So you will see changes on LinkedIn all of the time. And if there's something that I show you tonight that suddenly disappears, well, that's LinkedIn deciding it doesn't work anymore, they're not going to use it anymore, and they're going to do something else. But I'm going to show you something now which is really, really useful. And I'm just going to pull this over from my browser. Just bear with me one moment. Let me pull this up. Let me get my LinkedIn profile up. And here we go. There's Google. So I'm just going to pull up my profile. And this is the Help Center. Because any questions that you have about LinkedIn, this is a great resource for you to go in there and find out. So all you do is you hover over your photo. You go down to the Help Center. You click in here. And they have, of course, a knowledge base. And you can type stuff in here to find out, pull up articles and information on stuff that you want to know about. But the real secret down here is, if you go down to this point here, contact us, and you click send us a message, put your email address in there, details of what it is you're trying to do. You can even add a screenshot of things you're having problems with. Send it, and you'll get a response within 24 hours. And I've used this extensively over the years to build my knowledge of LinkedIn. It's far better, in my opinion, than messing around in the knowledge base to find the stuff that you really want to find. So there's there's one of my top tips for this evening. So let me just pull that back. In fact, I've shut the presentation down. So let me get the presentation back up. There we go. Okay. So moving on. So I asked you this in the document that I sent on the email, and this is, why are you on LinkedIn? Because if you don't know why you're on LinkedIn, then really you're not going to use it in the best way. And there may be two or three reasons you're on LinkedIn. Maybe it's for job search within your discipline or industry sector. Maybe you want a change of career. Career change, new discipline, sector. It's absolutely possible at whatever level, despite what people tell you or may tell you. Or it might be for some other reason. So I just thought we'd take a moment just for some of you to share why you're on LinkedIn, what the purpose of you being on the webinar tonight. I know some of you have told me, but specifically, why LinkedIn? Why not some other platform? What is it about LinkedIn that you think is important? If you just want to type in the question box any thoughts, and I'll share some of those as we go on. So let's give you a couple of seconds. Might be a time delay if you're based over in the States, or we've got a few people from all over the place, all over Europe, so it's good to see. So why are you on LinkedIn? Okay, somebody's put here that LinkedIn is the business professional platform. Well, absolutely. Absolutely it is. And of course, people know about Facebook, but LinkedIn is really, well, it's not Facebook for business, but it is the business networking platform. Somebody's put here, professional network to leverage and publish content. Now that's great. We're going to talk about published content later, because that's one of the ways that you can share your story and gain attention on LinkedIn. Looking for a new job. Yeah. Okay. Some people are saying that they can't see my presentation. What do I need to open or to view it? Well, you should be seeing it automatically. What I would suggest you do is if you jump out of the webinar and then jump back in, so use the same link as before, and hopefully that should resolve the problem, because I'm showing my screen. Can't see anything on the screen, so there's a few of you saying that. Let me just check. Okay, so the screen is being shared. Screen sharing. I've just shared it again. Let me try again. Okay, so screen should be showing now. I've just done that again. So could everyone just... Sorry, there's always some technical difficulties. Could everyone just tell me in the question box, can see it now? Can see it now. Brilliant. Excellent. Okay. Good, good, good. Sorry about that. You've not missed too much, and really I've just been reading some of the stuff and expanding on some of the stuff on the screen. The main thing is you can see my screen when we get into the practical application. So one of the things you need to think about when you're on LinkedIn is, if it is for job search, then you need to think about, well, what type of organization are you looking to work for? What type of individual do you want to work for? And also what the location is. And this is something I do as part of my Career Codex training, because, you know, many people come into the job market and they kind of leave their job search to chance. They register with a recruiter. They go on a job board, and something may or may not take their fancy. But actually, this isn't really the way to do it, because you've got to have a destination in mind. And the analogy that I use is, if you decide this weekend you're going to go away with your family, you're going to get in the car and you're going to drive somewhere. Well, unless you know where you're going, well, you're not going to get there. And you leave it to chance. You might end up somewhere nice. You might end up somewhere you thought you might end up. It's going to take you a lot longer. So you have to be very clear about what your destination is. And I help my clients construct what I call a destination statement, which defines the organization, the individual, and the location of that role, whether it exists or not. Whether it exists or not. The other reason you need to be clear on your destination is because when you start engaging with professional recruiters, either face-to-face or through the platform, then you've got to have a clear story to tell, and it's got to be clear and concise. And when I ran my recruitment company, the worst candidate for me to register and represent was the one that said to me, well, I can do anything, and I'm pretty open to anything. They thought they were helping me, but in actual fact they were hindering me, because I wanted them to be clear about what it is they wanted, so that, you know, I could help them properly and I could put them in front of my clients, and they would convince my clients they knew what they wanted. And that's a really important point. Okay, so I've introduced myself very briefly. I always think on these webinar things, and I do plenty of webinars, I'm a guest on webinars and this, that, and the other, I always think it's important you know who you're talking to, or who's talking to you, rather. I'm just going to give you a 30-second précis of my background, just so you know I know what I'm talking about. And very quickly, I trained as a chartered accountant, qualified with KPMG, went in search of a different career, and fell into the recruitment sector. And I spent 6 years working for a financial recruitment consultancy in the East Midlands, in the UK. Got to quite a senior level. I then fell out of love with recruitment and left. Went to Japan, had a life experience. I'm a martial artist. I enrolled on a course with the Tokyo Riot Police in Tokyo, Japan, in Aikido. Trained there for 12 months. Got my black belt, my instructor's license. Ran out of money, came back to the UK, and in September 2008, I started my own recruitment business. And those of you who remember 2008 will know that it was the worst time probably ever to start a business, let alone a recruitment business. Somebody's put, wow, you sound like Batman. Maybe not. There are some videos, actually. I don't know whether they're on my website, but there are some videos. If you want me to share them later, I'll perhaps do it. And came back to the UK and started my own recruitment company. Now, it was the recession. Nobody was recruiting. We didn't have a website. We didn't have a lot of money to invest in the business. But guess what got my business off the ground? Can anyone guess what got my business off the ground? Anyone guess? Type in the box if you can guess. There's a big clue in the title of tonight's presentation. LinkedIn, absolutely. Because what would happen, I'd worked in recruitment for a long time in this geography, and people would search for me. They wonder where I'd gone to, and they'd search and they'd pick me up in a Google search with my LinkedIn profile. And that's how I got started. So I didn't even need a website. So I started to generate business through LinkedIn. And for a period of time, LinkedIn was my website. It was my database. It was everything before we built our own database and expanded. Anyway, 5-6 years on, business did really well. I wrote a book, really prompted by the people that were walking to my office and didn't really understand how to navigate the job market successfully. Wrote my first book, Super Secrets of the Successful Job Seeker. And I'll just share that with you now. My first book here on Amazon, Super Secrets of the Successful Job Seeker. And I then wrote a subsequent book last year called Super Secrets of Successful Executive Job Search. You can see it's got some decent reviews on there if you want to go and have a look at that afterwards. And people started to approach me and say, well, will you, I've done it again, haven't I? Shut the presentation down. Let me pull the presentation back up. Too many buttons to click. And people started to approach me and say, will you coach me in the executive job market? And that's what I do now. So that's what I do for a living. So I help people to navigate the job market successfully to define, find, and secure the job they really want and not just the job they've seen advertised. And there's a big distinction there. So that's a bit of background on me. And if you go to my website, you can read a lot more if you would like to. So, still setting the scene, we're going to get into the practical stuff shortly, but I want to talk to you about the 4 steps to success in the job market, and LinkedIn forms part of this. And LinkedIn, if you can see my screen, is part of the process. You need to have an online representation in much the same way as you need a CV to be able to position yourself in front of recruiters and employers. But what many people in the job market mistake to do is they forget these other steps. And this is my methodology that I wrote and devised based on my 10 years experience in the recruitment industry. And the starting point really for any successful job search is to understand how the job market works. One of the things I'm going to share with you tonight is I'm going to explain how the job market works and how that will lead into how you should use LinkedIn effectively. So the environment is, well, okay, who are the players? Who are the key players in the job market? Who are the intermediary players? And what motivates them to action? Because until you know that, it's very difficult to engage with them properly. Next, we have psychology, because what we believe impacts how we think and ultimately how we act. And one of the challenges for executives in the job market is because you're at the top of the market, then it can become quite difficult. There can be less opportunities. It's fraught with rejection. It's very competitive. And sometimes the knocks you take start you to believe inaccurate things about your experience and skills. You think these things, then you take no action. So you get the result that you expect. And one of the challenges sometimes that I have with my coaching clients is a reluctance really to adopt LinkedIn as part of a strategy because of inaccurate belief that, you know, this is something like Facebook, it's not going to help them. And actually, when I encourage them to do LinkedIn, once I've trained them how to use LinkedIn, they start to use it and they start to believe it, they think about it, and they act daily to leverage the platform. And it's a very, very powerful way, as you'll discover, to really position yourself in front of people that can hire you. And it's one of my favorite phrases, which is that seeing is not believing, but believing is seeing. So if you believe that LinkedIn will be a solution for you, you're going to see it. But because you believe it, you'll take action and you'll get the result. So trust in that concept. Talked a little bit about planning. This is about defining your destination, who you want to work for, the organization, the type of person and where it's based, and then putting a plan in place to get there. Because in business, we have plans, we have targets to hit. It keeps us on track. It tells us what we're doing. We know if we're veering off track and how to address those issues. But when it comes to the job search, when it comes to executive job search, many executives don't bother. You know, they leave it to chance. So, you know, you're planning business, you need to plan your job search because, let's face it, it's the most important thing you're going to do this year. In fact, there's, okay, somebody's asking, is it 8 steps or 4 steps? Sorry, there's 4 sections, environment, psychology, planning. A process is the fourth step. And then there's 8 steps within process to success. Sorry, that's a bit misleading. It should be the 4 levels to success or the 4, whatever the word is. But yes, there's 4 headline topics which go into great detail. It's all in my book. You can have a look in my book, Super Secrets of Successful Executive Job Search. And then there are 8 steps to success. And one of those steps is LinkedIn. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about environment and how the job market works. Because many of you on the line tonight, I'm sure, have worked in senior positions and you worked in senior positions and you probably recruited in the past. And I want you to cast your mind back to think about how you ran a recruitment process. Now, I sat between employer and job seeker for over 10 years, and I can tell you that the majority of employers, both large and small, when they go to the job market, the first thing they'll do before they talk to a recruiter or a job board is they will tap into their existing networks. So managing director of a business will talk to their peer group. Chances are they know other managing directors who might know somebody that they could recommend. If they get nowhere then, they go to their extended network. Could be their auditors, their accountants, their lawyers, anyone they know through a networking organization, mastermind group, and they ask, who do you know? And then if they get nowhere there, they'll go out to recruiters and job boards. And employers really face three issues. They face pain, and the pain is a distraction. It's a distraction away from running their business. LinkedIn has presented them with an opportunity to find talent quickly, they use it. They use it now on a regular basis. Uncertainty, you know, when you hire somebody, you know, you meet them two or three times, maybe four times at the senior end of the market. You may do some psychometric testing, but you never really know what you're hiring or who you're hiring and how they'll perform. And, you know, employers are looking to mitigate the risk of making a bad hire. Again, LinkedIn pops up here because normally in a traditional recruitment process, if you wanted to reference somebody, you've got to wait till the end of the recruitment process when the offer's been made. But what LinkedIn gives you the opportunity to do is to vet somebody's recommendations because it's on their platform. You get a far clearer picture of them and their suitability for your organization because there's much more information on a LinkedIn platform. So it reduces employers' uncertainty, which is one of the reasons they use LinkedIn to find the talent they want to find. And then, of course, cost. You know, I ran a recruitment business. I didn't do it for free. You know, we would charge significant fees because people had to buy our time to do the recruitment process. So, you know, there's cost, both in terms of time, pain, distraction, the pain I've discussed, and there's cost in terms of money because you've got to pay a professional recruiter or a job board. So what you find in the job market is that if you're a executive job seeker and you rely solely on recruiters and executive job boards to find your next position, you miss the peer group, you miss the extended network. And what happens is you miss what I call the hidden market. And I would say, based on my experience in the recruiting for over 10 years, that probably over 50% of the jobs that are out there at any one time are probably not visible because they exist in the hidden market. And this is what the hidden market is. It's the conversations that happen between employers, their peer group, their extended network, before they ever go out to recruiters or job boards. And LinkedIn is your route to access these people, these employers, looking for people with your talent. It's their route to access you because, you know, 10, 15 years ago, it didn't exist. They would have to use recruiters, job boards, newspapers. But nowadays, they can access you directly, and you can access them directly, whether they're recruiting or not. You can build a relationship so that when they are recruiting, you're the first person they think of. And if you think about these as ponds, fish ponds, you know, the peer group is a very small pond. Extended network is a slightly larger pond. This pond is where all the candidates play, all the executive job seekers play. So competition is intense. And if you want to increase the probability of your success in the executive job market, yes, you've got to talk to recruiters and job boards, but you've got to have a strategy to access this hidden market whereby you'll increase the probability of success. And LinkedIn is one of the ways that you can do that. So this is a representation of the hidden market. It's a representation of some of the stuff we're going to talk about this evening. Job boards, professional recruiters, most people see this. It's very reactive. You place your CV on a job board, you register with a professional recruiter, a headhunter, a search and selection firm, and then you wait. You wait for the right opportunity to come along, and it can get very frustrating, hence the psychology element of the Career Codex course. This is the invisible line. This is the bit that most people don't see. But in actual fact, if they broke through this, there's this hidden market where over 50% of the jobs exist. And you have two opportunities to access that hidden market. You go direct to employers based on the destination you've defined. LinkedIn is one of the mediums to do that, and that's what we're talking about this evening. Or use another medium called market makers. And if anyone's read any of my books, I talk about market makers extensively. And market makers are well-connected individuals in a particular sector or industry space. So you imagine somebody who is the leading light in the aerospace sector. Now that person knows lots of businesses in the aerospace sector, lots of people in the aerospace sector. And if I had an aerospace business and was looking to recruit, that's exactly the kind of person I'd ask for a recommendation. So accessing market makers who are well-connected individuals opens up this peer group extended network opportunity for you to access the hidden market. It's a thing that most people miss, but actually it's the smartest way to find your next executive position. So here, of course, because you're taking the action, you're moving to a proactive, more empowered mindset, and you're in total control of every single step of the way. Not the results you get necessarily, because that's a probability thing, it's not certainty. You don't apply for a job and necessarily get it, but you're in control of the probabilities, and you learn from those probabilities, which feeds back into your plan, and you get better and better at executive job search, which is a profession in itself. This is where the majority play, this is where the minority play. And if you want to stand out, people talk about standing out in the job market, if you want to stand out in the job market, you have to play where the minority play. Any questions on that before I carry on? It's quite a complicated area. It's easy when you've sat in this space for a long time, but it can be quite a complicated area for people to get their head around. But I can tell you that, you know, my clients who I used to recruit for, some of the very biggest businesses in the area, they would always tell me, we're going to try and do it ourselves, Simon, because we don't want to pay your fee. And one of the ways we're going to try and find somebody is LinkedIn, hence the conversation this evening. Okay, so online positioning. You've got to think about who you want to position yourself in front of. There are millions and millions of people on LinkedIn, and a scattergun approach will never work. You've got to think about who you want to position yourself in front of. So that's an organization or a type of individual. You've then got to think about what kind of things they're searching for. So what words are they putting into the LinkedIn search engine to try and find somebody with your talent? I'm going to talk a bit about keywords when we get into the shop window element of tonight's training. And then the third thing which most people miss, you've got to think about when they're doing it. Because if you think about the status updates on LinkedIn, this is a bit like Twitter. So you know Twitter, there's a message out there, it lasts for about 20 minutes and it gets pushed down the pile because new people are adding content. Well, LinkedIn is very similar. So if you're posting status updates, I'll talk about that in a bit, about you, your business, the sector you know something about, then if you're doing that at midnight, and you're wanting to work for somebody who's awake between the hours of, you know, 6 a.m. and 10 p.m. well, you're wasting your time. So actually you've got to invest some time to do status updates and other activity on LinkedIn while people are at work, or while your target audience is at work. Because LinkedIn, think about email is kind of an instantaneous method of communication, albeit you have to wait for a response. People think it's instantaneous and expect an immediate response, but LinkedIn is instantaneous. And if you're going to have conversations on LinkedIn, then there's no point having conversations with people that are asleep. You want to have conversations that are with people that are in front of their computer at that time, because that's how you advance the conversation. So just think about those things. We're not going to dwell on them too much, but just think about those things. I want to mention this. Point two, what are they searching for? Now, when I was a professional recruiter, I would always do an advanced people search on LinkedIn. And that means that I would search in the search box for particular skills and talent. But what I would always do as well is I would find the right groups where the people I was looking for would probably base themselves. And I think this is in my book. It's a story I tell often. I was given a role by one of my biggest clients to recruit an IT auditor. Now these are really hard people to find. And I did the search, I searched my database, and then I posted a message in a LinkedIn group called IT Audit. And somebody just asked a question,
who are there. Yeah, it's the company hiring. Absolutely. Or it could be the recruitment company representing the company hiring. Absolutely. Good question. Good question. Thank you for that. And I posted a message in this group, and I got 5 responses. And of these 5 responses, 2 people look pretty good. And I contacted these 2 people. One of them I invited in my office to meet, and this person got a job and has been promoted, I think, a couple of times. He's been in this business for 5 or 6 years. Now, if he wasn't in that group, I probably never would have found him. So he knew where I would be looking, and he knew when I'd be doing it. In the middle of the day, I messaged him through the group, got an immediate response back. We met. The rest, as they say, is history. So think about that. It's very, very important. Okay, I want to talk to you very quickly, then we're going to get into the practical stuff, about something called the hire cycle. Now, wherever you go nowadays, you get bombarded with sales information, okay? And what we've learned to do as human beings is filter this stuff out. And we're kind of an untrusting society now. We always think somebody's trying to sell us something or whatever else. And there is something that I've devised, which is called the hire cycle, to explain one of the methods that you can use LinkedIn to build trust and to build engagement. Because LinkedIn doesn't happen overnight. You need to invest time in it. And in actual fact, to get on the radar of recruiters and employers in your industry space, you have to do things consistently over time. And this hire cycle explains that. See me, like me, trust me, hire me. And somebody mentioned published posts in the question box a little bit earlier. And published posts is an excellent example of how this works, because if people see your published posts or your status updates or the content you share through LinkedIn, they see it and they like it. They like it, so they start to follow you, because you can follow people on LinkedIn without necessarily connecting to them. So they follow what you're doing. And over time, they start to trust you. And then once they've started to trust you, when an opportunity presents itself, they contact you and you're in pole position for an interview, potentially to be hired. So see me, like me, trust me, hire me is an important concept. What most people, and I guess the recruitment industry's got has had a bad reputation for this, you know, they want to sell. You know, the cold calling thing is this: see me, buy me, see me, hire me. That's not what we do at Career Codex. Everything we do at Career Codex is about see me, like me, trust me, hire me. So one of the things people get nervous about, executives get nervous about, is, well, suddenly I've got to start selling. Well, no you haven't. And in fact, we don't do any selling. It's about positioning, and positioning is different. And some of the stuff I'll show you is about how to position yourself as an industry expert, a thought leader on LinkedIn, so you form you create an attractive message to the people that that you want to connect with, the people that can introduce you, hire you, recruiters who can introduce you to their clients. Okay, good. Alrighty, so last slide, then we're into the practical stuff. Mentioned it already, there's 2 approaches. There's the shop window. Dress your shop window, make your profile as good as possible so people want to stop and look at it. And then, that's the reactive approach, and then the proactive approach, that's this lady with a lasso, is you go out, you identify who it is you want to engage with, because you want to work for their businesses, and you go out and approach them and connect with them. Not in a sales way, but in a professional way. It's very, very different. So now what we're going to do, I'm going to open up my LinkedIn profile. So here's the changeover. Let's hope this works. Where are we? Okay, excellent. So here's my LinkedIn profile. And you might want to take some notes here. So I'll just give you a couple of seconds just to get some paper if you've not got any paper already. And I'm going to show you some of the things, not everything. And remember, you know, LinkedIn, you don't need to know everything about LinkedIn. And LinkedIn's a bit like, it's a bit like driving a car. All you need to do is to know how to drive it, yeah, to your destination, okay? That's all you need to know how to do. You don't need to know how it works, necessarily. You don't need to know how to fix the engine, because somebody else will do that for you. So I'm not going to show you everything on LinkedIn tonight. What I'm going to show you is some of the more important stuff, first of all, to create your shop window. So the first thing is, on LinkedIn, you need to think about your visibility. Because if people can't see you, they can't connect to you. So one of the things you need to check is your visibility on LinkedIn. And if you hover above your photo up here, you can go down to privacy and settings, and it will probably ask me for my password. Yeah, there we go. So I'll just pop that in. Hopefully that will work. It never works. It never works when I do on a webinar. Never, ever. There we go. I missed one of the keys. Okay, and a couple of things for you to check. This is the engine room of your profile. And the two things that you probably want to check is who can see your activity feed here. Because your activity feed is your status updates, and your status updates are really important for communicating information about stuff you know about to get people's attention. So this needs to be set to everyone. Yeah, if it's set to your network, your connections are only you, then you're talking to a limited audience depending on the number of connections that you have. So you make sure that's everyone. And the other thing to look at down here is edit your public profile. And if you click in here, down the right-hand side, you see here, make my public profile visible to everyone. So if this is clicked here, then you're invisible. And it amazes me that quite a lot of people don't know about this privacy and settings thing, and you need to really make sure that your privacy and settings are set properly so that you can be visible. Okay, somebody's asked a really good question. How about your existing boss? People in the company follow you as well. Absolutely. Now, what I would say on that note is that majority of people in business nowadays will use LinkedIn as part of their business development activity as well. And having a LinkedIn profile doesn't mean anymore that you're looking for a job. It just means you've got a LinkedIn profile. Because anyone who's going to consider doing business with you is going to check out your LinkedIn profile. I can tell you that. 99% of the time now. So it doesn't mean you're looking for a job. And if your boss asks you, well, why are you doing all this work to your LinkedIn profile? Well, it's because I'm trying to help the business. You know, that's essentially what you're doing while you're in the business. Yep, it may help you to get a job, but, you know, it's how you position it, as with everything. As with everything in life. So make sure this is done. The other thing up here, LinkedIn, when you create your LinkedIn profile, gives you a standard public profile URL. And you can change this. So you can put your name at the end, your job title, your industry sector. What that means is you can share this URL in your email signatures, on your website, on your business card. And it's not a string of numbers that nobody can remember. It's actually your name. So the important thing here is to make sure that you do that, because if it's in your signature strip on your website, then people are going to find you. People are going to connect to you, and it's all about building connections, because as I said earlier, building connections increases your visibility. And some of you may remember the game of Conkers. I used to play at school. And if I had a Conker that had beaten 50 other Conkers and you had one that had beaten one, then if you beat me, you got 50 points, and that's how it is on LinkedIn. Somebody's put, thanks, my LinkedIn profile looks different. Yeah, we're just in the privacy and settings bit here, so it's probably going to look the same in a moment. So a lot of people ask me, in fact, let me go back here. A lot of people ask me, well, should I connect to people I don't know? And people are often nervous about connecting to people they don't know. But let me ask you a question. The chances of the next person to hire you knowing you currently are probably quite slim. They may do, or they may not do. But if you're not connecting to people you don't know, you're potentially missing a trick. So I have a rule that I will connect to anybody on LinkedIn. But the rule says that if they suddenly start spamming me with sales information, which some people do from time to time, then I will block them. I will stop them looking at me. I will disconnect from them. So they have one chance, and that's it. You will see people on LinkedIn who are lions. Let me see if I can demonstrate that to you. Anyone know what a lion is on LinkedIn? This may throw something completely random up. Ah, here we go. No, it's not going to show me. No, it's pulling up businesses with lions. But if you see this, L-I-O-N, and it's not a business called Lion, what it essentially means is that is somebody who is a LinkedIn open networker. And that means they've publicly declared that they will connect to anybody. So you're free to connect to them. What do you think the most important thing on your LinkedIn profile is? Anybody, please type in the question box. The most important thing on LinkedIn. Most important thing. Anybody. Okay, good. Somebody's put the photograph. Absolutely. Why? First impressions count. Professional business photo. And the thing that people miss is the eye line. I see a lot of photos where people are looking off to the left. If I'm looking at that photo of me and my eyes are over here, immediately I'm taken off the page. It's a small, subtle difference, but we're trained as human beings to follow the eye line. So I'm inviting people to take a further look at my profile. By the way, I'm in the edit profile mode at the moment. If I click here, you'll see what my profile looks like to you. So I'll stick in there unless we're going to edit something. So make sure you've got a professional photograph. Pay somebody to do it. Get it on there. I like black and white. I like to change it up every now and again, but my eye line will always be the same. Okay, somebody's asked a question. Val's asked a question on connections. How many connections should I have? As many as possible. 2,500 is great. I've got 4,500 or thereabouts currently. 2,500, you'll find it quite difficult to find people that fall outside of your network. When I'm doing training on LinkedIn, I sometimes struggle to find people that I'm not connected to as either a first, second, or third tier or group connection. So 2,500 is great. LinkedIn has a benchmark here, 500. Once you start to get above 500, then you're in pretty good shape. But the more, the merrier. And then, of course, it's not just about volume. It's about the quality of those connections. So to use the aerospace example, if you're looking for a job in aerospace and 50% of your connections work in the aerospace sector, that's better than 10% working in the aerospace sector. But generally, the rule is the more, the better. Okay, professional headline. This is this here. Now, professional headline is probably the second thing people look at. And this tells people what it is you do in a snapshot. And I use stars because it catches people's attention. You just cut and paste these from Word. And my profile doesn't say career coach. It doesn't say anything like that. It tells people what I do. So thinking differently to help people find the right career, my website, careercodex.com, and businesses to grow, PembridgeGrey.co.uk. That's my non-exec director company where I work with recruitment companies as a non-exec director. So it does what it says on the tin. Now, there was a while back where people would often put their phone numbers and email addresses in here, and I read something online that said that LinkedIn started to penalize people who did that. So I don't know whether that's true. It's one of those things you read, you're not quite sure, but I removed my phone number. Your contact information is here, and you need to make sure you've got contact information here. Phone number, email address, company website, Twitter handles, you can connect Twitter to LinkedIn. We're not going to cover that this evening unless anyone specifically wants me to, and if we have time. But having your contact information, this is the place to have it. So contact information is really important. It's also important to have it in your summary down here. You see, I've got mine here. Okay, and I've got it at the bottom of my profile somewhere down here as well. Advice for contacting. Down here. So I've got it in three places. One of the most frustrating things as a recruiter was when I found somebody's LinkedIn profile and I thought, wow, I need to talk to this person. And I couldn't find their contact details. So make it as easy as possible. As easy as possible. Yeah, somebody's put, as a sales executive, it's very difficult to find the right professional headline. Absolutely, it is difficult. You've got to take some time. And you need to think of it a little bit like a newspaper headline. So newspaper headline, what would captivate somebody's attention? That's what you want to do. It's an invitation to treat. It's an invitation for somebody to read your profile a little bit more. Okay, so just think about that. Think about that. Next thing we're going to talk about is summary and experience. People often get confused between the summary and the experience. So the experience relates to the jobs that you've had, the positions you've had with various businesses. And linking this back to your CV, your experience is really about your achievements. So what was the value you added in those businesses? A brief summary about what the business does, what sector it was in if it's not immediately obvious. But most businesses will have a company page, but it's good practice just to say something about that in there. And then some key achievements, because key achievements are what supercharge a CV, and they're also what supercharge a LinkedIn profile. Because why do people hire people? Yeah, they hire people who are going to add value to their business. So if you're going to communicate anything through your LinkedIn profile, you need to think about what value you've added in the past, because what you've done in the past is a reasonably good indication as to what you might do in the future. Okay, great question. What should the sentence say? What should your headline, professional headline, say if you're looking for a job? Okay, so I would put the sector that you're in and a description as to what you did in your last role. Okay, and I would then put actively seeking opportunities or considering opportunities. So it's evident in the headline that you are considering opportunities. People will contact you anyway, whether you're not, but you know, I would put that. Don't just put looking for a job, because people aren't going to find you the wrong kind of people might find you for that. You want to put your sector and, a bit like I've done, what difference you make in the world in your previous role or in the job that you're looking to get. So summary is really where you pull out some of the key things that, if you want somebody to get a snapshot as to the value you can add and dilute some of the more comprehensive achievements down here, this goes in your summary along with your contact details. You have to complete both. I see so many profiles where people have done the summary, and then when it comes down to this, they just haven't done anything. Remember what I said at the start about LinkedIn's advice? You've got to complete all of the sections completely. Well, you've got to make sure you complete your skills and experience underneath each of the roles that you've held. Okay, skills and endorsements. So if you go down here, you'll see this, skills and endorsements. And you can have 50 skills or endorsements. And this is where you tell LinkedIn, this is what I'm good at. This is what I want people to endorse me for. And you, if you go onto LinkedIn and you go onto somebody's profile, you often see a box appear at the top up here, and it says endorse this person for these skills. If you click that box, they get a little credit down here that says, yeah, this person's good at that. And you know, I've worked hard at building my career coaching executive search credentials here, because previously I was a recruiter. So you know, 3 years ago, that changed when I formed Career Codex. Your top 10 skills you want to put at the top. So you can have 50, but you can drag and drop if you go to your edit. Where are we? Edit profile up here. Edit profile. Click on edit profile. Drop down to this box. And you can drag and drop your top 10 skills, the skills that you want to be flagged up for people to endorse more often than not. So a bit like, probably the analogy I would use, the content you put in here is like keywords, yeah, on a website. So a website needs to be keyword rich for you to be found. Down here is a bit like a Facebook like, Google plus one. This is somebody saying, yeah, this person does what they say they can do. And linked to that sort of social proof aspect of LinkedIn, recommendations are hugely important. Okay, so you'll notice that for all of the businesses that I've run, my current business for Career Codex, yeah, I've got 10 recommendations. You've got to work hard to get recommendations because it's social proof. What do I mean by social proof? Well, social proof is that it's not you saying how good you are, it's other people confirming how good you are. And going back to what I said earlier about an employer's nervousness about the uncertainty of hiring, this is where you give them some comfort that you're the person that they should hire. When I was deciding who to bring in from in terms of executive search firms for this beauty parade, for this business I was helping, I looked at how many recommendations the recruiter had. And that was part of my decision process as to who to bring in, because I wanted to be made comfortable that the person I was going to introduce could do the job. Okay, somebody's asked, how many skills and endorsements? Is 20 enough? Have 50. Remember what I said earlier, have as many as you can have, but work 10 hard. So select your top 10, and your top 10 drag to the top. See how these are featured differently to down here? So this is the mass. These are the things that you want to be endorsed for. But have 50. Okay, good, good, good. Okay, and the other thing I want to talk about, shop window, is making your profile sticky. And you'll notice that my profile has got videos. That's a video. That's a PDF article that I wrote. Here's another PDF. This is when I was on the BBC. I've got some stuff up here. So this, that's when I was featured in ICAW Economia magazine. What else have we got? Got a few other things. Ooh, let's go back. Oh, sorry about that. It's very easy to get lost in the platform. So there's various things on here that I put out there. And I put them out there because people like pictures. Yeah. If people can see that I've been quoted in magazines, I've written articles for this magazine, that magazine, on career coaching, whatever else, they take you more seriously because you establish yourself as a thought leader. So it's very, very easy to add this kind of content. If you haven't got the content, that's fine, doesn't matter. But it's very easy to add this content using something called SlideShare. And if you go under interests here and drop down to SlideShare, you can create an account in something called SlideShare.net. It allows you to upload videos, documents, and then what you can do, you can directly import those to LinkedIn by clicking a button, and they'll then appear on your LinkedIn profile. And it's a really great thing. The other thing it said in that document that I read at the weekend about LinkedIn is that SlideShare is hugely important. So if you're at the executive level in the job market, at the executive level anywhere, then what you should be trying to do is to position yourself in the public domain. Get comments, get published in magazines, and all you need to do is ask. I've just had an article published in the Institute of Directors, Director magazine. It's a national publication. I think it's actually distributed internationally as well. How did I get that? I found somebody on LinkedIn who was the editor. I contacted them in the right way. We had a bit of a dialogue, and they invited me to write a blog, and they published me. I use LinkedIn to do it. You can reach anybody you want in the world if you know how to do it properly. And I'm going to show you how to do it properly now. So how do you connect to somebody you don't know? Okay, this is the thing that people get scared about. Wow, I don't know this person. What am I going to do? So it's very, very easy to do. And you'll notice that I don't use the paid premium platform. You can pay on LinkedIn. You can pay on LinkedIn for a premium account. You can use something called InMail. It's a bit like paid email. I don't particularly like it because it's not personal. I know if somebody emails me, they've paid to reach me. I would prefer a more personal approach, and this is how you do it. So I'm just going to type a random name into LinkedIn. So let's go for Brian Jones. Let's go for, if you're on the line, Brian, I apologize. This hasn't been planned. So, okay, I don't know this guy. He's based in Washington. He's a second tier connection. What that means is that Mike Hunter is a connection in common. So Mike's connected to Brian, Mike's connected to me. Now, there used to be something on LinkedIn called Get Introduced, and I queried this with LinkedIn through their help center a little while back because it disappeared. And they've actually taken it away. They don't tell anybody, but they've taken it away. So if you actually click that, it doesn't really help you any much. Well, it doesn't help you very much at all. So that facility at the moment's been taken away. But if I want to connect to Brian, well, all I need to do is, assuming I'm not going to pay to connect to him, all I need to do is to click connect. And what I do, this is what I do, you don't have to do it, but I've done this for 10 years. You click, we've done business together. I pick my most recent company. You see, I've had quite a few positions. So let's pick Career Codex. And I write him a personal message. What I never do is just send the invitation like that, because it's impersonal. He doesn't know why I'm getting in touch. Essentially, it's spam. But if I write a message to Brian and say, I read something you'd published, had a look at your profile, looked really interesting, it really resonated with me, one of your posts, it'd be a privilege to connect on LinkedIn, this guy's going to be flattered, he's going to connect back to me. And once he's connected back to me, I then have an opportunity to send him a longer message should I decide to do so. But in any event, I've built my level of connectivity. Now, some people have a bit of a problem with saying they've done business together. I don't have a problem with that. Other people may. It's worked for me. Providing you put the personal message in there, then you're absolutely fine. 99% of the time. Okay. Yes, Julie, that's a great question. I'm going to come on to that shortly when we get on to proactive engagement tool. Okay. Julie's just asking about, can you use other people's material? So the other thing I can do is I can have a look at which groups Brian's in. So, Brian's in various different groups. Now, if I join one of these groups, then I can send Brian a message directly as a fellow group member, because LinkedIn has a special type of connection called a group connection. So, if I go into one of my groups up here, I'll just pick one at random. And where are we? My groups. Okay, let's go into this one. If I click in here, what I can do is I can look at all of the members. I can then look at who these members are. Any of these members, it'll pull my first tier connections first, but any members that aren't first tier connections, I can just click this icon and message them directly, because we are group connections. So if you want to reach somebody that you can't reach in any other way, then connect to the join the group that they're in and then connect to them as a group connection. Really good bit of advice here, and it's something I call the job seeker dichotomy. I mentioned this in my book, and it basically says that whenever you approach somebody online, or whenever you approach somebody in recruiters or whoever, you've always got to make it about the other person first. Make them feel special. Reference them. You've read something, you're interested in what they've said, rather than about you looking for a job. You don't even mention that at the moment. You don't even mention it. It's far, far too early in the conversation. And remember, see me, like me, trust me, buy me. If you're on LinkedIn and all you're talking about is looking for a job, you're never going to get past the see me, like me, trust me, hire me. Hire me, not buy me. Hire me in terms of the job market. So you've got to think always about the other person and reference something you've seen that they've perhaps posted or commented or whatever else. So if you were trying to connect to me and you landed on my profile, I mean, you've got loads to go at. I mean, you could keep you busy all day looking at some of these articles. And you know what? Nobody ever emails me and says, you know what? I saw that article on your profile. I thought it was really good. It would be a privilege to connect. If somebody did that, I would have absolutely no hesitation in connecting to them. And that's how I get results, connecting to people that other people either too worried about connecting to, worried about rejection. This is what I do, and it works. And I build my connectivity. The more connections they have, the more connections or the more reach that I have. Of course. So let's talk now about LinkedIn as a proactive engagement tool. And I've already talked about see me, like me, trust me, hire me. This is about you building a presence online, a bit like a personal website, which means you need to invest some time. And the things you can do on a daily basis, the things you can do on a weekly basis. One of the things you can do is share an update. And this goes back to your question, Julie. So you have three options here. If you click on the homepage, share an update, upload a photo, or publish a post. Now, share an update, this is where you share interesting content that you've found. You share, if you write your own blog, you share your own blog post. And it's relevant stuff for the kind of target market that you're looking to reach on LinkedIn. So if you're trying to find I think that video is distracting me a little bit, so let me try and shift that down. That'll disappear in a second. So if you're trying to find a job in the aerospace sector, you talk about stuff that's relevant to the aerospace sector. This is the kind of stuff that you shouldn't be sharing on LinkedIn, by the way, in my opinion. That's more for Facebook. But anyway, so you share content that's relevant. You can then take the URL, what goes up here, and post that in relevant groups. And if you do this on a regular basis, you start to build a relationship with your connections, and they come to you as a source of relevant information. Now, it doesn't always have to be content you've created. It can be content that you've got from elsewhere, but all you do is reference it. This is a great article that I found, written by da 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 da. Mention their name, you acknowledge them, they're happy, you've shared their content, and your connections are happy because it's relevant material for them. So, Julie, hopefully that answers your question. Okay, Val's asked a question. Notify your network is off. Yeah, so there's a button here. And actually, this relates back to, let me see if I can find it. It's on the, I think it's on the edit page. Okay, notify network. Yeah, here. Notify your network. So if you're making lots of changes to your LinkedIn profile, you don't necessarily want to tell all of your connections that you're doing them. So you just turn this off periodically. So if you are looking for a job and you're beefing up your LinkedIn profile because you are looking for a job, just turn this button off and your connections won't be notified of all the changes that you're making. very good question, Val. Thanks for mentioning that. We could spend hours on LinkedIn. I'm just trying to give you the headlines, but there's always be stuff that more stuff that we could talk about. Let's talk about published posts. These are probably the most important thing in terms of building your reach on LinkedIn, aside from groups. So you can write blog posts. Okay, you can put an image, you can put a headline, and you can start writing about stuff you know about. And one of my first executive clients, got him on LinkedIn. He's on LinkedIn, but he didn't really have a presence. I encouraged him to write a published post. If you've never written a blog before, it can be quite difficult. Have a look at some of mine to get some inspiration. And he wrote this blog post, shared it with some of his connections, with some of his groups. People started to share it. Suddenly his message was viral. And he was talking about stuff he knew in his industry sector. Now, published posts are important, and we know they're important, because look where they sit on your LinkedIn profile. They sit right at the top. I've written 51. They sit right at the top. And that's LinkedIn saying creating content is important. This is the first thing people who land on your profile will see. So it's very important you create some published posts and talk about stuff that you know about, stuff that people who are looking for people like you to work for their businesses will see first off and find engaging. Let's talk about groups. Now, groups, this is where you supercharge your experience on LinkedIn. If you go to interests, you click on groups. There are groups on everything. Okay, there are groups on everything, and because I'm in the executive search space, I join groups where I know people who are looking for jobs or help with navigating the job market exist. So US jobs, Europe jobs, CEO, finance director, CFO careers. And I purposefully picked these groups because I know that if I have conversations in these groups, then people are going to start to see my message, like my message, hopefully trust what I'm saying. And at some point, they'll raise their hand and say, Simon, do you know what? Could you help me, please? Oh, and there we go. There's my tonight's webinar in that group, which I posted earlier today. But how do you behave in groups? Well, how you behave in groups is that you listen first. Okay, so you get the temperature of the room and you have an opportunity to like what people have said, to comment on what people have said, because it's a dialogue, it's a conversation. It shouldn't just be all about you posting stuff about you. It should be about you engaging, contributing, helping, and offering to help. And one of the best bits of advice for LinkedIn groups is if you go over here, once you're a member of a group, and sometimes you need to wait to be invited to be a member of a group, having clicked this button, but it normally doesn't take more than 24 hours. You go over here. This is a hot tip, so please get this if you get nothing else. You go on to admins, and you've got three people. You've got the owner of the group. This is the guy that created it. He's connected to 19,471, or has at his disposal 19,500 people. And these are the admins. I always connect to the owner of the group and the admins of the group. And I send them a message saying, thank you ever so much for allowing me into the group. Looks great, really keen to contribute. Is there anything I can do to help you? Would it help if I blogged? Can I help you in any way? Guess what? These people are market makers. Yeah, I talked about them earlier. They're market makers. Okay, so connect to these people and send a personal message. Somebody's put awesome. Thank you. Thank you, Val. It is. It's an awesome tip. It's an awesome tip. Nobody does it. If you do it, you stand head and shoulders above everybody else. Okay. Good, good, good. So you can have 50 groups, up to 50 groups. My advice is to join 50. You search them up here. Got the drop down here. Tick groups. Search in here if you want to find a group on aerospace. I keep talking about that. I've got a few aerospace clients recently, that's why. All of these groups you can join. Yeah. You want to find a balance between the groups with that are niche enough to be most relevant to you, but also where there's a captive audience. You know, you don't want a group that's got two people in. You want a group that's got a few thousand people in, but you've got to get the balance right. You can't contribute on a daily basis to 50 groups. It's impossible. So I probably do one post in each of my groups every week. So this is a weekly thing. Daily thing is I do a status update every single day. Weekly thing is I post in a group, one of my groups at least, and published post is something I do more or less once a month. So I know in a space of 12 months, I'm going to have 12 published posts on there, because you can't, you know, you've got a job maybe at the moment. If you're not working currently and you're using this as part of your strategy, somebody's asked me, how many groups do I participate in? About 8, David, about 8 groups, but I'm an active member of those groups. And it takes all of this takes time, so you've got to invest the time to do it on a daily basis. So we're going to get onto some Q&A in a moment, but I'm just going to jump back into the presentation. We might run over sort of 5 minutes tonight, but hopefully that's okay. It's always quite difficult to time because you never know what questions you're going to get. So let me just pull back this presentation. Oh, I've done it again, haven't I? I will learn for next time. You live and learn. Okay, so action is everything. I've shown you tonight some of the ways you can supercharge your profile, but you can walk away from this presentation tonight and not do them. If you do them, you'll start to have better results on LinkedIn, I promise you. You've got to make connections. Oop, sorry, jump forward. Goodness me, I'm having some trouble with my mouse this evening. Make connections. You've got to do this one by one. That's the best advice. There is no fast way to make connections. There's a fast way to make group connections, but first-tier connections one by one. And why does it need to be one by one? Because you need a personalized message. But think about it. If you make 2 connections per day, 5 days a week, for 48 weeks of the year, by the end of the year, you'll pretty much have your 500 connections, which gets you over that LinkedIn threshold where you've got 500 plus. So in 12 months' time, even if you've got 1 connection today, you'll have 500 connections. And what you find is when you get more and more connections, people want to connect to you because they understand the power of connectivity. Join and contribute to groups. So don't just join and do nothing. You've got to contribute actively. Listen first, comment, like, and then share your published post. Share your knowledge, share your experience. We live in a knowledge economy now, and there are people out there that want to know what you know. Think about my business career codex. That's exactly what it is. People want to know what I know about the job market, the inside track to how to navigate the job market successfully. And in your sector, you'll have knowledge and experience that employers will value in their businesses. And you just need to educate and tell that story. See me, like me, trust me, hire me. Publish posts. I would challenge you all within the space of a week to do a published post. And if you share it with me, send it to me via email or share it with me on LinkedIn, I'll share it, I'll comment, I'll critique it, just do it. The first one won't be the best. We live and learn. We all make mistakes. I've made a few mistakes on the presentation tonight, but that's how we learn and we develop. That's fine. But don't let the fear of somebody not reading your post or somebody not liking it or whatever else stop you doing it, because you've got to put your head above the parapet to be seen and to be found. And consistency. Spoke a little bit about consistency. Consistency is absolutely critical. You've got to do this thing on a daily basis. So I'm going to do some Q&A in a second, but there's a couple of things I just want to talk to you about. And for some of you, the help and guidance that I've given you this evening is absolutely enough, and that's absolutely fine. Absolutely fine. But I wanted to tell you about a couple of things that I do, just in case it resonates with you and it's something that you would be interested in finding out a bit more about. And I run a couple of different things with regard to executive career coaching, because I know it's a lonely place. One of the things that the executive career coaching job market strategy stuff does, it gives people accountability, it gives people support to make sure they're confident in what it is they're doing. And it also gives them education that they don't get elsewhere, because they've not seen the inside track as to how the job market works and how to best approach it. So next week I'm starting something called starting the April 7-week transformation program. And this is a private weekly training for 7 weeks. Private weekly training for 7 weeks that I do for about 20 people. And we cover, in fact, let me just pull this up and I'll show you. That's probably the easiest thing to do. Where is it? Here. Okay. In fact, let me I'll pop the link in the box, so if you want to have a look at it your end, you can is that working? I know why. Let me get that here. I need to pop it in the chat box. And I'll type it there, and I'll share that now, so you should see that. So this is it starts in 5 days. All the sessions are recorded. We cover pretty much all of the Career Codex methodology, environment, psychology, planning process. Seven sessions, Wednesday, Thursday evenings, usually 7:30 GMT. If you can't make a session, the session is recorded and sent to you afterwards. It's also shared in a private LinkedIn group. So one of the benefits of this course is that you have a community. So you have a private LinkedIn group. You have peers in there. You can ask questions of your peers, and I'm in there every single day to answer your specific questions relating to your specific job search challenges. So if you want to have a look at that, then please go ahead and have a look at it. As an incentive to people who've been on the webinar this evening, I am offering a special discount for the next course. I promised I wouldn't do this again, but as you good people have been on the call tonight, I decided I would do it. There is at the checkout, there is a code. If you type this code in, which is webinar30mar, M-A-R, I'll just put that in the group share box. If you click on one of these buttons, you type that in there, the promo code, apply it, you'll get a 20% discount off the cost of the course. So have a look at that. That code will expire at 11 p.m. GMT this evening, and we get going next week. So if it's of interest, you'd like to really supercharge your job search, and I've given you some of the free stuff tonight. Hopefully you found that useful. If that was useful, then imagine what I'm going to share with you when we get into the detail of the stuff. So hopefully some of you might be interested in that. Brilliant. Okay. The other thing that that I do very quickly, because I never really like doing this bit, but I think it's important. If you've got a message to share, got to give people an opportunity to learn more. If people want to just come on the webinar for free, that's absolutely fine. But if people want more, you've got to give people the opportunity for more. I also offer private one-to-one coaching. This is where I work one-to-one. Obviously, this is more expensive because it's one-to-one. If you go to my website, I'll drop a box in here. I'll drop that in. Just bear with me a second. This is my Executive Edge program. This effectively is similar to the 7-week transformation program, although the 7-week transformation program lasts a little bit longer. But this is private coaching, and I tend to run this over a 10-week period, one hourly session, hour and a half session every 2 weeks. As with the 7-week transformation program, it's not just a show up and listen to me. I give people actions to do between time, because there's lots of work you need to do. Things like thinking journals, things like CV, things like this. I critique all of that and give you feedback and really help you to navigate through the job market successfully. So if you're interested in that, you scroll down to the bottom here. You send me a message. Tell me a bit about your situation, why you might be interested. What I'll then do is I'll send you a questionnaire and we'll schedule a call to talk about it. This is by application only. Because it's personal, it's got to be the right fit. I don't work with everybody. It's got to be the right fit for you, it's got to be the right fit for me. So one of the ways you can fast track that is if you want to fill this job search assessment questionnaire in, you can do that instead, or you can just go to the bottom here and send that across. So there's two options there. 7-week transformation program starts on Wednesday, group career coaching, executive career coaching specific to the executive job market, or private Executive Edge course, which is one-to-one private coaching, generally done over the internet, but you have an opportunity to speak to me face to face. Okay, good. Alrighty, let's do some Q&A. So, I've done it again, haven't I? I've shut down the presentation. Anybody got any questions for me? If you have, please fire them into the box, and I will do my best to ask them. I'm going to stick around for 5-10 minutes. So if some of you need to go, that's absolutely fine. Remember, if you are interested in the 7-week transformation program, 11 o'clock tonight, that code will expire. Ahead of that time, you're at 20% off the cost of the course. And that will be in the email that will go out to you an hour after we finish the broadcast tonight. Okay, David, great. What's a good approach for a connect request to someone you don't know? Okay, the best thing to do is to go onto their LinkedIn profile, have a look at some of the stuff that's on there. Have they got some articles like I have? What are they saying in their status updates? Perhaps like one of their status updates, comment on it, then send them a connection request using the way I showed you earlier, that says, hi, such and such, read your status update, really resonated with me. It will be a privilege to connect with you on LinkedIn, please. I use that all the time. What a nice thing to say. It would be a privilege. It would be an honor to connect with you on LinkedIn. And it is. It is, because you want to connect with this person. That's all you do. That's all you do. Simon, have you... Okay. Oh, sorry. I'll try and do these in order. There's quite a few coming in, actually. It's great. Okay. I saw the LinkedIn in Sales Navigator. Are you experienced with that? I've used Sales Navigator. I've used all of the premium platforms. What I would say is that, yes, there's a reason for them. But everything I've showed you tonight, you can do without paying for it. And it can get quite expensive. One of the benefits of using something like the Sales Navigator platform is that when people look at your profile, you can see the history of people who've looked at your profile. With a free service, you can see the last, I think it's 5 or 6 people. It's quite useful to know who's looking at you, because it's a clue who might be interested in your experience. You could try these things for usually a 30-day trial. If you contact LinkedIn directly using the contact request box, they'll give you a free trial. And from time to time, they'll send you an email message to say, do you want to do a free trial? I do the free trial and make a judgment yourself. For me, it doesn't quite work. And I actually don't really like using email, because I think it's impersonal. It's like email. I know someone's paid for it. I would rather they approach me in a different way, having read something I've done, commented on something I've said. It personalizes it. And this is about personal relationships. Okay, I miss your point about lions, Lindsay. Okay, on people's profiles, what am I looking for? Okay, all you're looking for in their headline, in their header, let me pull that back up. So up here somewhere, up here, it will have, that's my edit profile, it will have the word, it will have the letters capital L, capital I, capital O, capital N. And that means LinkedIn Open Networker. So if you see somebody who's a lion, LinkedIn Open Networker, all they're saying publicly is, if you connect to me, I'll connect back to you. Yeah? If you connect to me, I'll connect back to you. But I view the whole of LinkedIn as fair game. I believe everybody is there to be connected to. If you want to connect to them, you just use a personalized message to do it. Simon, have you any advice for wording of endorsements? I think you probably mean recommendations, Bruce. Endorsements are the things down here that you pick from a list that LinkedIn presents you with. So you can't pick what they are. Did you mean endorsements? I mean, I'd put your top 10 here, the things you want to be found for. If you mean recommendations, Bruce, you don't write the recommendation. Somebody else writes the recommendation. And in fact, you've reminded me of something I didn't cover earlier. If you want someone to recommend you on LinkedIn, don't just send them a recommendation request through LinkedIn. Okay, phone them up and say to them, I'm doing some work on my LinkedIn profile. Would you mind if I sent you a LinkedIn recommendation request, please? They'll know to expect it. You've asked them politely. And what you can offer to do is, if they're busy, you can ask them to give you some feedback. You can write this down. You can type it up. You can send it to them and say, look, I wrote down some of the stuff you said on the phone because I know you're busy. If you're happy with that, could you post that for me as a recommendation? But please feel free to make any changes. You've not created this yourself. You've listened to what they've said, having got some feedback on the phone. You've then written it up, which is the hard bit to do, sent it to them. They've had the opportunity to edit it, and then they post it for you. That's one of the ways around to get people to do a recommendation. People who aren't used to writing them procrastinate about doing them because they're busy doing other stuff. Okay, Simon, you do not have the ability to connect on LinkedIn. Sorry, Derek, I don't understand the question. You do not have the ability to connect on LinkedIn. If you want to clarify the question, Derek, I'll gladly answer that one for you. Wow, there's loads of questions coming in. Okay, Simon, how do you introduce yourself to a recruiter directly regarding a job? Val, if you do nothing else, get a hold of my book, Super Secrets of Successful Executive Job Search. There is a whole chapter, in fact, actually I won't put the link in there. If you go onto Amazon and search for it, you'll find it. There's a whole chapter in there on how to engage with professional recruiters properly. Okay, there are various ways to do it. A lot of the stuff I've talked about this evening, but there's a detailed chapter in there. Invest $12.99, you'll get the answer. Alrighty, but make it about them is what I would say. Job seeker dichotomy, talked about that this evening very briefly. It's in the book. You've got to make all your conversations about the people you're engaging with. Okay, can you please show me the route to the group founder admin again? Yes, of course I can. So group founder admin. So you go up here. That wasn't the sound going funny. That was just me getting excited about going to the groups. Okay, interest groups. So, my groups. I'll just pick any of my groups. So I'll go for the recruitment network this time. So this is the group. This is where I can start a conversation. I click on members here. Go over here, admins. There's the owner. Just one owner there. In fact, there's no admins. Well, he is an admin, but he's an owner as well. Okay, all good. Okay, thank you for providing this webinar, Simon. It's really been giving me a wealth of information. Thank you, Melissa. Thank you for joining. How do I connect with you, Simon? Fantastic. Great question. Let me show you. In fact, it's on my last slide. Let's try and shut down the right thing this time. You see here, I've got 4,500 first tier connections. If you connect to me, you're going to have 4,500 new second tier connections. All you've got to do, in fact, let me put that link directly in the chat box. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go to my profile. I'm going to I'm going to copy that. Appreciate we've run over a little bit, guys, so if you do need to go, I completely understand. I won't take offense, but if some people have got some questions, I will stay here and answer your questions for you. So I'm going to copy that, and I will pop that in the box here so you can connect to me. I'm presuming, can somebody just let me know if you're seeing these links pop up in your chat box? Can somebody just let me know that? Who asked me that question? Derek, can you just let me know if you can see that? Yeah, okay. So please connect to me. And if you're watching the replay, again, please connect to me. It's Simon Gray ACA. That's the URL. Okay, a word about keywords, please. I'm atypical and don't know which words get. Okay, so what you want to do with regard to keywords, so one of the tricks with keywords is if you're talking to recruiters about specific types of jobs, ask them for some sample job specifications of roles they've recruited recently and ask them what kind of words they would search for on LinkedIn or on Google to find somebody like you, because they will have a good idea, because they do this day in, day out. And in fact, with keywords, you can only ever guess at what somebody may search on to find you. In actual fact, the best way to find out what somebody would search on is to ask somebody what they would search on. So keywords are important because it's what you need. It's a bit like flags, signals on your profile that says these words are important and I know people are searching these words, so I'm going to be found for these words. So I'd ask a professional recruiter. It's a great question to post in groups. And again, not wanting to force you to buy a copy of my book, but I do talk about that in my book, Super Secrets of Successful Executive Job Search. Okay, Simon, I have a pretty good LinkedIn profile, but don't get any recruiters. Okay, like I said earlier, Val, you've got to go to them. So I would connect to professional recruiters. I would start to do some of the more proactive stuff, proactive engagement tool stuff. They'll start to see it, because I can tell you they're in groups all the time watching. They are in groups. They're in every single group. LinkedIn is dominated by professional recruiters. So just because they're not connecting to you doesn't mean you can't go and connect to them. I would ask you, is it clear what kind of opportunities, what kind of sector you're interested in? If not, if they're confused about what your offering is, they may bypass and go to another candidate. Greg, should I accept invitations from people I don't know and have nothing in common with? Absolutely, because you don't know who they're connected to. Okay, I said earlier on the call, I connect to anybody, but if they start to spam me with information, then I disconnect from them. So they have a one chance. Of course, you need a volume game, but you need a quality game. So yes, you want more connections, but if my 4,500 connections weren't relevant to me, then it wouldn't be very good, weren't relevant to my industry sector. Some of them won't be, but it gives me visibility with their second and third tier connections. So work hard in groups to make connections of group with group, first tier connections in groups, because you know those people are relevant to your industry sector. Okay, do you recommend to accept the connection request from a recruiter? Massimo, absolutely. Recruiters are some of the best connected people on LinkedIn. So, while they may not have an opportunity for you, you know, you're getting access to their to all of their connections. You're going to be second tier connections to all of their connections. They may hide the visibility, but you know they may not. So absolutely. Okay. Wow. So many questions, guys. This is great. This is great. Okay, Derek. Thank you. Thank you, Derek. A few people dropping out now. Steve, thank you. Links coming through. Thank you for letting me know that, Val. You never quite know this end. Influences. I'm glad you asked that. I think it's Ibrahim. Yes, influencers. We didn't mention LinkedIn Pulse this evening, but there are influencers on LinkedIn. And if you go down here, I think there's about 500 influencers, and you used to be able to apply to be one, but now it's a very select group of people. So it's people like Sir Richard Branson, other business people, you know, all sorts of people. Here we go, Bill Gates. I follow some influencers, and great idea to follow influencers and to like their content, to share their content, and also to connect with them directly if you can. Some of them won't allow you to connect directly, but some will allow you. They will definitely allow you to follow. And there was a little while back that I did a published post, and this published post suddenly got shared multiple times. And what happened, I worked out, was that an influencer had shared my published post with their community. So, you know, if you look at Richard Branson, you know, look at this, 9 million followers. So if Richard Branson picks up one of my posts and shares it with his 9 million followers, there's a pretty high probability that my post is going to get read. We're not connected. In fact, I'm probably going to put that right. So I'll probably connect to Richard, because I'm pretty brave like that. And my belief is you can connect to anybody, providing you have a good story to tell them when you write that personal message. How do you recommend? Yeah, okay. Accept connection requests from recruiters. Definitely. Connect. Yeah, so Val, good summary. Connect with professional recruiters, publish posts, and be active in groups. Good summary. Okay, Derek, thank you. Okay, thank you. Thank you. I think we're probably about done. Let me just see if there's anybody still on the line. Okay, there's 18 attendees. A couple of minutes. I'm going to stop at the hour. If there's any last-minute questions, then just let me know. And remember, opportunity. If you are so inclined, for the 7-week transformation program, and also for executive career coaching. If you do need some extra help, if you don't, absolutely fine. Absolutely fine. Thank you ever so much, Bess. Well, that's a nice message. Hey, Simon, this has been great. So generous. You're a star. Thank you. Thank you very much. I do try my best. Okay, guys, thank you ever so much. I hope that's been useful. I hope that's helped you think differently about how not only how to use LinkedIn, but how to think about your executive job search in a slightly different way, because that's really what it is all about. It's about thinking about your executive job search in a different way. Observe the masses and do something different, because that's really what standing out is all about. If you ask anybody if you ask any employer, any recruiter, anyone in the career coaching business, and say, well, how do I find success in the job market? They will tell you, well, you need to stand out. But what most people don't tell you is how to do it, and that's what Career Codex is all about. So good night, wherever you are. Thanks so much for joining, and you're all subscribed to my newsletter now, so I'm going to be doing a webinar at least once a month, so I hope to see many of you again. Good night.